Warm welcome to you all, on your computers, online. My name is Markus Milbich, and my colleague Mark Simon, and I will talk to you about intrinsic flame retardant polyimides and other flame resistant reactive matrices at DETF Dinkendorf. Just a few words to the German Institutes of Textile and Textile Research. We are Europe's largest textile research center and have approximately 250 employees, a turnover at altogether from 26 million, 25,000 square meter area of lab, laboratory and technica, and all sorts of research, public and industry, many partners around the world, and have also test customers and have a small production services. The next. We are a textile full step research institute. We can go from molecule to the product. We start from polymer. We functionize our own polymers. We produce fibers and yarns out of our polymers and other polymers. We do fabrics and we do the functionality of the fabrics. And we go even to the product because we say the first 1,000 pieces or the first 1,000 meter of textiles are produced within our facilities. And then the companies are sure that they have got the right product for their production line. Our research areas are high performance fibers and yarns, the textile finishing and coating, fiber composites and lightweight design, smart textiles. We have a big department of medical technologies and textile 4.0. This is the German of digitalization, the German word for digitalization. And for sensors and so on. Next. Some highlights, we have the High Performance Fiber Center, where we have high-end equipment, where we test new technologies and we develop new technologies in case of high performance fibers. For example, we have a nice facilities for the research of ceramic fibers. For sure, high temperature applications with the entire production chain, worldwide top positions where we have, and we develop new oxide fiber types, for example, mullet or CTA. And we also do have the ceramic fibers incorporated into ceramic mattresses and have fantastic possibilities about that. Then the lightweight technologies, for example, we have a carbon fiber facility here where we produce carbon fibers from renewable resources, cellulose, lignin, and also develop energy and cost efficient processes. So we go into a little bit more into the fiber reinforced composites. We have 3D textiles facilities, weaving, braiding, and pultrusion. You see some examples here. We have a spacer weaving or other ORV, open reed weaving technologies. We have braided and woven FRP connectors, for example. We do straight and curved profiles with all sorts of matrix systems and fiber systems. And also we have projects where we incorporate fibers into rotational molding. We are working close together with Arena 2036. This is a Forschungscampus at the University of Stuttgart. We are engaged in the lightweight construction through functional integration. For example, with the ORV weaving machine, we can have a glass fiber cloth where we incorporate carbon fibers where we need to reinforce the load passes. And in this case, we save money because not the whole textile is carbon. Only the fiber parts are made with carbon fibers. This is woven into the woven fabric. We developed a carrier, as example, a carrier floor battery integration with integrated liquid sensors and cooling, or have developed a textile charging coil for safe wireless charging of e-textiles, e-vehicles. And the parallel project FOPRO, this is a German project where with the partners you see on the left side above, and we developed a glass fiber polyamide seat, back crash seat, and we have the crash past. We get a nice back seat about this, and where we developed the low shrink polyamide, we have braiding and comlining at the ATFF and the braiding. And you see the white tube in the button are 12 braided textiles on one of made from 12 braided textiles. Thanks. Next. Then recycled carbon fiber is also a topic where we have recycled carbon fibers commingled with PA6 and PP fibers, which are processed to yarns, tows, and woven fabric, tapes. And so the slides before you saw, we use in many applications polyamide or polypropylene. And the question is the fire retardancy of polyamide and polypropylene. So you see a fabric woven at Lindau-Denier with a commingling polyamide and carbon fibers, or pressed parts manufactured by Elring Klinger also with polyamide. So the question is, in the normal textile industry, we need fire retardant polyamide, the usual textile industry, but also we need polyamide also in the lightweight composite department. For example, in the next slide, you see the project TexX, smart textiles in the exterior of tomorrow's car. You see also, you see the Twizy with a textile floor, a textile door. And also here is a question, fire retardancy. For sure, we have lower mass and functionalization by means of electrical sensors and actuators in the exterior for lighting, anti-theft, noise, or haptics. But also here is the problem of polyamide or polypropylene with flame retardancy.
Okay, then welcome from my side too. We start with the flame retardancy at the DITF, but first a little bit about the current situation of flame retardancy, and besides of the growing applications in FRPs, PP and PAs are really important and widely used. Then the biggest part is for the production of textiles for polyamides, and it's an expanding field. And we have about 400 dead people only in Germany to fires or the release of toxic gases because of fires. And that's why we are come and play to help with intrinsic flame retardancy. But first, let's look at the state of the art at the moment. We know there are existing flame retardants, but they have advantages and disadvantages. As used as additives, which is the usual way, it's we particulate incorporated, and then we have the problem. It's not really permanent, the flame retardancy, because it can migrate out of the polymer. So there are cheap ones like aluminium hydroxide or magnesium hydroxide, which have high melting points, but we need high filling degrees to use it. To use it as material. And that is really problematic in the fiber sector, because there will be a change of properties, of material properties, and that's what we try to avoid. We need usually another substances in combination, which can be toxic, which have other things what we don't have. What we don't want to have, and that's why we need better ideas. And that's the goals of the DITF Denkendorf, we equip the polyamides, for example, with an intrinsic flame retardancy by the incorporation of copolymers directly by the polymerization of the polyamides. Or we do intrinsic flame retardancy of polypropylene by the reactive extrusion of phosphorus-containing flame retardants for the PP. And so, and what our goals are then, the flame retardancy should be consistent and effective for a long time. The amount of flame retardants should as low as possible, and so the cost will be reduced. And it should be, in the end, less or marginal changes in material properties. And how we can reach that? In our case, for the polyamides, we use commercial available flame retardancies like HPP or UCANOL-RD. And those we incorporate in PA6 or PA66, which we have patented in 3 different patents, which you can see here. On the left side, you see we did a salt of the HPP and the hexamethylene diamine to use it with the H salt to incorporate it by polymerization and polycondensation in PA66, which is the master batch with a high content of flame retardancy, which is too much. So we can dilute it either way with PA6 or with PA66 and compounding it. And then we have flame retardant PA6 or PA66. Then we can do the same one with the UCANOL-RD and come to the same results. And what we also did, we used the HPP and the UCANOL-RD as it is, as phosphorus compounds in the polymerization of caprolactam to PA6. But here the problem is those components are chain regulators. So we have to be careful of that. And this is also patented. But before we go to the flame retardancy, I want to say what we measure or our burning behavior. We have 2 different tests. The first one is the LOI test, the limited oxygen index, where we check how much oxygen needs to be in the air to ignite the sample. And here we have definitions, because we have around 21% in the usual air. So if we need more, then it's good. And we define the self-extinguishing for the LOI, which is over 24% oxygen, or is it already flame retardant at LOIs over 28%. And there's another one, the horizontal and vertical burning test, in accordance to the UL94 test, where the best results are the VO, what means extinction of the samples clamped vertically within 10 seconds. Okay, let's start with the PA66. Here we have solutions with viscosity around 2, but we can go higher to 2.4, 2.5 as possible. And how can we do this? We do this in the master batch, as I told you before. And here we have PA66, for example, which is mixed with PA6 in a ratio to 1 to 9. And then we have a phosphorus content in total with just only 0.09%. And that is enough to get LOIs. You can see them here on the bottom, around 40, which is far more than we need for flame retardancy, which was 28. And as you can see, and here is a reference sample, and here on the right side are 2 flame retardant samples, and you can see the elongation, the tenacity, and you see they are almost the same. So so the material properties are not really changing, which is that what we wanted. Then we go to the PA6, where we incorporate the flame retardant UCANOL-RD or HPP, here in different percentages, and you can see if we have 5 percentages around 0.3, then we have the relative viscosities going down compared to the reference here, which is 2.3, which is a common viscosity for a PA6. But if you go down with the phosphorus content around 1.0 or 1.10, then we have the same viscosities as the reference, and that's what we need for the flame retardancy. So it's here you can see the spinning trials, and you can see the elongation, the tenacity, and the Young's modulus are almost the same. So here we don't have any material changes, but you can see the limited oxygen values here, the PA reference with around 21%. And if you go for the 0.1 or the 0.15, then we have already 35% of oxygen we need. So this is in accordance to the YO at the UL94 test, as the same for the PA66, which I showed you before. Let's sum up the results. We have a relative viscosity over 2.3. We have very low phosphorus content. We have high molecular weights. And we have no influences on the typical material properties. We have usual tenacities and Young modulus. And we have LOI values around 35 and 40. And we have OY at the UL94 burning test with all our samples. Okay, and then we developed furthermore, or the University of Stuttgart, the IPOC, developed in small scale latent catalysts where we can mix it with monomers. And then we have one component ready to polymerize material in a latent state. And then we just need a trigger like light or heat or ultrasound to get the catalyst in the active state. And then we can polymerize the system like PA6. In this case, this is not really flame retardant. But now we are honored to modify the caprolactam to a flame retardant caprolactam, and we can do this also with flame retardancy. Then I'm giving back to Markus Milwig for the rest of the part, rest of the talk. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. I think Mark showed you some nice results regarding the PA6 or PA66, the thermoplastic composites. But we're also doing going into biocomposites and biopolymers, stable fibers, and we're going also composites from biogas plant residues. And also, question is fire protection. Flame retardant materials, UV protection in the biocomposite sector. We developed cellulose matrix, cellulose fiber composites, and also the question of fire retardancy in pertuda profiles. And here in the biocomposites world, we have a double strategy. We use DOPO and also standard flame retardant, and we mix both, and we see nice results in the biocomposites field. But if you go in even higher temperatures, the thermoplastics are not really enough. So we go in different projects in construction, for example. We have a Transregio 141 project where we develop biological design and integrative structures. And here, in this case, we use the carbon fibers we use in a cement matrix. It's a nice mock-ups for the carbon fiber reinforcement. Also, we use a phosphor cement matrix system, which is, for example, used in the braided gallery of the Berlin Opera. This is a phosphor cement mask. We do also different projects about phosphor cement matrix, and this matrix is stable till 1200 degrees. Stable when heat is applied. Also, in the epoxy field, we're using DOPO as fire retardancy. And the fire protection construction, we have also a patent on the carbon concrete composite, where we're doing transforming a phenolic matrix into a non-combustible carbon matrix. Either we use a heating oven or a microwave power in pultrusion, where we transform the phenolic matrix into a carbon. We carbonize the phenolic to a carbon matrix. Well, it's not only plastics we use for matrix system. Also, we have a project together with the Max Planck Institute of Plasma Physics, where we experiment or we develop metallic matrix systems, where we incorporate metallic fibers into a copper matrix. And Alexander von Müller, with whom we go together in this project, get a nice soft innovation prize of the European Commission. So, and not only we're strong in the production or research work, we also have the competence center of stable fibers weaving simulation, where we simulate the processes, the textile processes, and can also have CT scans and can go down to 0.7 microns. We're looking very deep into the textiles and see if we have voids or if the fiber layout is not correct. In our management group, we have a global warming potential life cycle assessment and also a material flow cost accounting regarding energy material cost. And those guys of our management group, they have big experience in counting CO2 emissions, evaluate the process alternatives, and they are dealing with connecting economy and ecology of our textile processes and also of our composites. Well, thanks for listening. Here is the note of thanks to all the DFG and BMWE and BMBF and the IF for the money which we get from. And thanks for listening. And I think, Mark, we are open to questions.
So let's see how that goes. If I know.
So are there questions?
Can you see the question? No. Wait. Ah, I need to. Okay. Okay, the first question. Do these flame retardant additives create corrosion of metals? No, because they incorporated in, they have acids, you are right, as functional groups, but they are incorporated inside the polyamides, so there isn't any corrosion, because all the functional groups which would cause problems are polymerized, and so they are not there to produce corrosion, for example. Okay. Well, that works really well. It isn't commercially available yet, but one of the patents is licensed, and you can. I'm not sure if you can buy it already, but they are producing it already. And they're producing it in different ways. From textiles for clothes, for example, to carpets, and technical textiles. Everything is possible. So like usual polyamides. So I hope that answered the question.
Mark, the question was the linear density. Is it higher or lower or of the usual PA? Is the Dichte, is it higher?
Text or linear. No, it's almost the same as the usual ones. Okay, what temperature are these fibers able to withstand? Yes, but so it's usual. It's a D norm where we measure the burning behavior. So that's around 300 to 600 degrees. But it not really withstands. It's cooling, but it's not burning. It will be decomposed at those temperatures, but it's not burning. So the materials afterwards is destroyed, but it won't burn and it won't drop any droplets of burning or of hot polymer. Okay.
And as I mentioned, the polymeric, the phosphor cement, which I introduced in the later foils, the later slides, it is stable till around 1,200 degree.
You're right. The ceramics are much higher. Yeah.
Ceramics are much higher.
Okay. Thermoplastic matrix using RTM process. Yes. We are trying this at the moment, and we have some good results. We're trying it at the moment, so the results should be there in a few weeks, if this is possible. But we think there because the materials properties are quite the same, so we don't think there are any problems with RTM, for example.
Yeah, Mark, we have to differentiate. The caprolactam will be used in the RTM process in pultrusion and in RTM.
Yeah.
The other polyamide, the usual polyamide, we do co-mingling. We spin the thermoplastic matrix fibers and we co-mingling the thermoplastic polyamide with the glass fibers and the carbon fibers.
Yeah, and so what we are trying at the moment.
Ways to deal with it.
Yeah, the incorporation of the flame retardancy, exactly, that we are not using for ATM, but the modified caprolactam we can use for RTM. Yeah. Okay. And
can you incorporate the new material also in urethane acrylate resin? Is it would be possible, Mark?
We haven't tested that yet, but if it's possible with usual polyamides, it should be possible with our polyamides as well.
Yeah. Well, we should the urethane backlate, we should test. It's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Good idea. Thank you. Okay, that is all of the questions I had here in the F&A models. So if there isn't anything left, then we thank you again for listening and have
Mark,
a nice day.
Or, Mark, yeah, Mark, if our contact data over our contact at DETF, you will find www.detf.com.
Exactly. There you can find us, and we have you can also find us on the fair. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have our own. I saw it in the morning that we are on the fair. Yeah. Okay.
Online. Okay.
Thank you and bye-bye.
Okay, thanks. Have a good time.